So this is a project that I released not so long ago. I think it was in October 2019. It's called The Dating Brokers. In May 2017, together with Tactical Tech, as I commissioned, we bought 1 million dating profiles for 136 euros on the internet, just like that. Yeah. This piece is just basically like the output of it. We just output all this data here. We tried to anonymize everything as much as we could. But basically what we got are 5 million profile pictures, again, for 136 euros. Along with very detailed physical descriptions, interest of people, mailing addresses, gender, sexual orientation, and anything that you can imagine that you can give out in a dating profile, right? I'm not gonna ask how many people has a dating profile here, but just so you know, like, this data is for sale and it's right in the web. I didn't even have to go to the dark web to do that. So here's where I bought the profile. We won't have time to go over the website. I will do this tomorrow in the workshop. But basically, that's the website I bought the profiles from. And basically, you can see like there's like these hot sales. Everything like is quite spectacular, right? And there is different packages that you can choose. I bought like 100 profiles for worldwide profiles, which include more than 30 countries. Most of the profiles that we got were from America, but there were profiles from Sweden, from Germany, from Spain, from Thailand, from Philippines, and so on. Yeah, and basically you can just go here and choose everything. There is sugar daddies packages, which, whatever this means, there is multimillionaires packages of data, and so on. There is a lot of segments of data here. Yeah. So after we bought this, yeah, here you can see some of the packages. Yeah, 347,000 Latin American male profiles, $70. Latin American female profiles, $214,070. Yeah, so after buying these profiles, the main question was like, okay, how can this data be sold? First, I wouldn't know, I don't know if this is cheap or it's actually expensive. I don't have a reference to say whether data is so cheap or expensive. But it's like, how come it can be sold so easily? Yeah, so then I started to research, and it's something very common in the online dating business to exchange profiles between platforms. Yeah, either you pay for them or just you exchange them without the consent of the user as well, without the conscious consent of the user. Yeah, it's meaning that you can have a profile in, I don't know, let's say OkCupid, and your profile can end up, and this is, yeah, might end up in Tinder or in other platforms. Why the companies do that? Because they need a lot of new faces all the time to generate more traffic and to get paid subscribers to the websites. Yeah, but it's something that is completely known inside the dating business, not in the user end. There is also a very interesting business or sub-business in the dating industry. It's called white label dating, which is those companies that offer you all this architecture, like they can build a website, they make you the marketing from the website, and they also pre-populate your own website with profiles. Yeah, this one in particular, I think they, like the basic package comes with 60,000 profiles. I asked these guys where the profiles came from, they never disclosed the origin, but they say, yeah, it's real profiles from real people, and they are quite updated. Another one, Skadate, dating. There is not little, it's not that you choose US date and these guys doing this. I mean, it's quite, it's not a massive industry, but it's quite a big thing. This is the database that we bought. We had like more than 630,000 male profiles and sort of half of the number in female profiles. Yeah, and that's basically sort of the real pictures that we got. And this, we got a CSV file, which was so messy. It was CSV file, I think it weighed almost 1 gigabyte, which to be a CSV file, it's crazy, right? So that's what we got for 136 euros. And this was like the, yeah, some of the stuff that we got there. And the next question was like, okay, where are these profiles coming from? And we started to analyze those sorts of reverse engineering some of the pictures, yeah? With very standard methods. Not, we didn't do like some very extensive work here because we didn't need to. But basically we ran some EXIF software in the images, and we realized that a big portion of the images that we took, they had this image software POF. The image in the left It's the image from our database, okay? And we checked, we saw that there was like one of the leads that gave us, it was this image software, POF, yeah? And then we compare it and I said, okay, it's POF, what is POF? And then we realized it's this website called Plenty of Fish. I don't know if some of you know it. It's the second most popular online dating site in America. Yeah, they claim to have more than 500 million users, active users, which I doubt. And they have more than 51 or 50,000 new subscriptions per day, yeah, according to Plenty of Fish. So then I said, okay, let's take just, of course, an image from Plenty of Fish and then run some EXIF data on it, EXIF software image data, and we got sort of the same, yeah, image software encoder. You see, EXIF, POF. Say, okay, that's like a lead. It's probably they're coming from there. Also, the structure, the way the CSV file was structured information, it was equal to the information of the Plenty of Fish, like the first questions that they ask you, sort of like the structure of the database, it really matched what we had. So that was the second lead. But the third lead, we checked some of the profiles from our database where we just checked if they exist in Plenty of Fish. And we found, and we didn't find one, two, or three, we found many. And there were profiles that were still active in Plenty of Fish. Yeah? So basically we knew that almost most of the profiles that we got, they came from Plenty of Fish. Then I wrote USDA, the company which I bought the profiles from, and I sort of tricked them with some questions because they never wanted to disclose the origin of the profiles. And I asked them, do you have profiles from Plenty of Fish? And he told me, yeah, we have millions of profiles from Plenty of Fish. Yeah, so that was like the fourth verification. So, okay, that's like, okay, so what is Plenty of Fish? Yeah, this is it. So Plenty of Fish, it's part of Match Group. Yeah, it just sister company of Match Group. The parent company of Plenty of Fish, it's Match Group. And Match Group also owns Tinder, also owns OkCupid, and also owns more than 100 to 200 different line services, yeah, which, according to their privacy policy, they share info on profiles to each other. Yeah, and this is something that you sign up in the terms and conditions when you open a profile in any of these websites. This means that you have, if you sign for Tinder, your profiles or information about yourself can be shared on all these 100 to 200 different line platforms. And even you can find your profile, why not, in some of these other platforms. Yeah, it might happen, it might not happen, but you give the permission to this to happen. And after this, it's like, okay, this was just the tip of the iceberg, because then digging a little bit further, we understood that Match Group was part of this interactive corp. I'm not sure if you know, it's one of the biggest internet companies in the world. It's American, of course. And they own services like Vimeo, dictionary.com, that by the way, dictionary.com, in the early beginnings of the internet, was this website with most trackers in it. And we could map a total of more than 300 other companies linked to Yak. Yeah. So altogether, we had like already around 500 companies, online services that could potentially share information with each other. And this is just the tip of the iceberg, because this was just from desktop applications. Yeah, we couldn't research, well, we didn't have the funds or the resources to research on apps. Yeah. But the thing doesn't end up here. Yeah, those are some of the companies owned by Yak. Yeah, Daily Burn, Mythic, also is part of it. Investopedia, they also have the Daily Beast. Yes, online tracking of this process of collecting data in an anonymous and silent way of online activity of a user. Yeah, so you do anything you want online, and there is like all these, I call them invisible parasites, that are basically in the shape of script and other different types of technology that they just suck information, yeah? And nobody knows what they're really sucking. But this is basically how our online life gets quantified and commodified afterwards. So we run some scripts to determine all the third-party trackers that in desktop activity that had access to all these 500 approx online corps, online companies and services that could have access to these profiles, and we could map around 300 third-party trackers. Yeah, which then we checked the companies behind it, and yeah, well, more or less it was, I think it was around 200 different companies, which is not little. So all together, we could map, and again, this is just the tip of the iceberg, a network of 700 companies and online services that potentially monetize these profiles and potentially can monetize any profile that is done through any of the services from Match Group or Yak. Yeah? And well, that's just how we assembled the website. It's just like online auctions. The project is very silly. It's not rocket science, right? We just took the data and we just arranged random auctions to understand what sort of information we have and how basically all these data brokers, basically as these companies that are in charge to organize, segment, and sell data, how they could just segment the data in order to sell it and make it available, right? This is something that is the first time that they do it in some of my works. Like all the research behind this project was so juicy and it was so big, and like the findings, I think that were quite important. We did this piece of investigative journalism that explains exactly what I explained now, but more in depth, like step by step, how we acquired these profiles, yeah, how we research, and like all the maps, all the companies that I just mentioned, yeah, one by one. Here you have all the information, all the companies, all the trackers, who is who, what is what, all the amount of money that those companies make on average per user, which in the last quarter of 2018 was $54 per user, and we're talking a company that has millions and millions of users, right? So you can just multiply, and that's how they make the, that's how they take profits, right? So this is another project that it's called Algorithms Allowed. This was done in a residency created by Tatiana Vaticelli in Solitude and ZKM. It was a web residency. Google Analytics and other US services in forms of cookies are embedded in websites and servers which are in countries embargoed by the US, like Iran, Syria, Sudan in that time. This idea in 2017. Cuba, and this is not the country, but the Republic, Crimea, yeah? The region of Crimea in Ukraine. So just, this is very, very simple. I'm gonna explain here like how the Google Analytics cookie works, because it's the most used in the world. So Google Analytics, I'm sure that some of you have it in your website. It's basically, it's a piece of code, yeah? That once you access a site, it activates, it records data derived from your online activity, yes, such as your geographic location, which websites you might have visited before, which website you're gonna access in the future, browser, computer, blah, 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 blah. This data is sent to a Google server, which nobody knows to which Google server will go, but potentially to the US, right? Elaborates a report based on this data that it was collected, and the complete report is available on the Google Analytics website, which is hosted again in a Google server. Location, who knows, but for sure there is a copy in a US server. And how this started? Because I was asked by a curator to participate in this very weird exhibition in eBay. So we had to do weird stuff to sell in eBay. And I said, okay, so I'm gonna go to like Democratic Republic of Korea. This was not under the Korea top level domain, but still it served as a joke. I said, okay, let's see if there is Google Analytics, yeah, right here, or Facebook Connect, or any US-based code, or US the company-based code that they can use. And yeah, I found, indeed, Google Analytics here. Yeah, and I found that this was quite enough, very contradictory, right? I said, okay, this is very funny, okay, that's enough, I don't want to work more in this, I'm going to send this. So I just made up all the page, everything looked nice. Yeah, I made all the auction, I wrote all these tags, and then I was just ready to say, okay, just publish it, and that's it. But after I just pressed the publish button, I got this message, which was, of course, delivered by a bot, which said, yeah, attention sellers, embargoed goods. eBay's policy prohibits sale of most items that originate from North Korea. Due to sanctions enforced by the U.S. Department of Treasury Office, blah, blah, blah. If you list such an item, it's a violation of this policy, and then we remove the item and we'll ban you from use our services. So I get, okay, understood it, just publish it anyway. Look at this, in red, yeah? So it's like, wait, you cannot do this. Embargo gods, that's it. And then I felt that this was somehow very weird. So there is like a bot that tells me that I'm selling items from North Korea and that this is illegal, which the only thing I'm doing is like to sell a TXT file, which I just copy-paste some source code from a random website of North Korea, yeah? But then I realized and I understood like all these acknowledge agency that algorithms have, because this indeed had a huge agency on me. I couldn't do what I wanted to do, yeah? And I couldn't do anything about it. That's it, I just couldn't do it. And this was like an algorithmic chit-chat, right? And where I was left, nowhere. So I started to research, and I went to this Office of Export Control Services to understand which other embargoed and sanctioned countries the US had in that moment. So as I said, it's Crimea, Cuba, Iran, North Korea, Sudan, and Syria. Prohibit all transactions, including imports and exports, yeah? And targeted sanctions also include items, certain export of items, data, and of software without a license authorization, yeah? Which I claim that most of the people that put cookies, Google Analytics cookies, they are not asking for permission, yeah, to the US government in this case, like especially if you're coming from Iran or Sudan or whatever. So I said, okay, so Google Analytics, Facebook Connect, and all this, when you do this, I explained before, there is a transaction of data, and this transaction is illegal according to the US foraging policy, right? So I just started to check, like, the president is the president of the website of the official website of the president of the Republic of Iran, Google Analytics, which I said, well, this is, it raises some questions, right? Because it's not that the US put this data here, it's just like the webmaster of this website just decided to put Google Analytics there, but there is like this transaction of data with the US company and Iran, which I'm sure that Google at the end detects some benefit out of it, right? It's prohibited by the US. So obviously there is like a huge gray legal area here, or I don't know. Okay, the organ, the official organ of the Central Committee of the Communist Party in Cuba, Google Analytics and Facebook Connect. The e-government of Syria, Google Analytics. And so on and so on. Also like the Ministry of Defense of Sudan has Google Analytics, Ministry of Defense of Iran as well. So I thought that it was something worth to look at it. And that's the web page. You have like all the findings here. Yeah, North Korea has just a website because at least in 2017, I just checked the top level domains. And North Korea had just 28 available websites registered in their top level domains. But even though with this, 28, two had American trackers, yeah? And they were embedded in the jQuery libraries that they were using. Yeah, so the whole thing is like very twisted. Because you don't expect this, but they are there. They had Google fonts in some jQuery libraries. Anyway, the list is there. So then another central point in my work, and I think it's basically the most critical nowadays, it's like all the environmental impact of all these processes that go beyond the interface. Yeah, that we don't see, as Ben Gordon and Daniel just revealed. Yeah, there's all these hidden infrastructures and there's all these hidden processes that just waste a lot of energy. Yeah, and they take a lot of natural resources. This is a piece I did in 2014, which basically tries, and it's an estimation, tries to calculate the amount of CO2 in real time derived from the visits, global visits to google.com. Yeah. So basically just a counter, once you open the website, it just this number goes up and up and up and up. Again, as we've seen previously, the internet is such a complex infrastructure and probably it's the biggest system that humanity has ever built, and it's built by so many actors and there's so many things going on which is impossible to determine its exact emission, which I think it's a huge problem because we have a huge problem. We should be able to do that. Yeah, because most of our daily transactions are being carried through a connected device, right? Anyway, so this is was just an attempt to embed this or try to bring this to the social imagination, because it's quite amazing that this is not connected in our brains, or most of the people know that anything that you do online, it just causes, it has like an environmental impact, yeah? And it's something that's completely marginalized in the way that we interact with the interaction is designed with the web, yeah? With the internet, with connected devices. And then I did this other project, which because I think it's very hard to get to people just through numbers. Also for me, numbers, they overwhelm me, but a lot of times they say a lot, but they don't say anything, right? At the same time, it's for me, it's very, very weird to relate to them, especially when it comes to things that matter, like environment. And then I tried to create another thing that you had to watch in a website, and of course also wasted resources, which is this project which tries to calculate the amount of trees needed to observe the emission generated by Google.com in real time. Yeah, actually it's completely estimated, it's speculative, this just fills up, it's 23 trees per second, and at the end the browser ends up like collapsing after 10 minutes or something. Yeah, it's not designed, it just happens like this. Yeah, but I think it's crucial to at least try to reveal these problems in a way that people can understand them, right? And yeah, have agency, solve something, I don't know for now, yeah? But for now it's really important just to reveal all these processes, I think. Okay, this is like the most punk project here. We set up this project which is called Institute for the Advancement of Popular Automatisms. It's a joke. Yeah, but it's sort of a project that allows us to play, because the projects that we do are quite hardcore, are quite heavy. They have a lot of political implications, have a lot of activism, and sometimes you just need to free a little bit your brain, right? And relax a bit, I don't know. So anyway, we collect all these slogans and the graphic identities of a lot of data broker companies, a lot of analytics companies, a lot of data science, a lot of all these guys like Palantir, like many, many other smaller companies that they just basically trade with data, yeah? And I'm gonna show it after, but like there is Franco Berardi has this brilliant quote that said that we live in a world that is poorly functional, but without signifier or without meaning. Yeah, it's a lot of function, but not a lot of meaning. And I think that this exactly is. This is, well, one of the slogans. We will live in augmenting human intelligence, not replacing it. The next one is one of my favorites. Financial freedom for the underbanked. Whatever that means. And this, we are using machine learning to disrupt consumer lending and meet the financial needs of people around the world. Yeah, and this is just like very small examples. It's full of it. It's called data mercenaries. I forgot to mention that. Yeah, so yeah, it's all that goes and goes and goes. I need to fix it because I did this very, very fast, but people mentioning Sun Tzu. Well, just this. I mean, this is supposed to be a beast, just to be a... But yeah.
Fast is better.
Fast is better, always. Yeah, so anyway, I leave it here. Thank you.